They're coming to get you, Barbara.
I was dragged to see the original Night of the Living Dead.
Oh, no! No! Johnny!
It was the most scary movie I had ever seen.
It was black and white. It was crude. It was Pittsburgh. It was really a great idea, very creepy. People trapped in a place, claustrophobic, with things out there trying to kill them.
It was a little rough around the edges and a little raw and grainy, yet it had this kind of nightmarish quality.
It certainly didn't have a budget, so it had to have something. And the something that it had was a group of people who really wanted to make the scariest horror film that they could.
Around 1986, I started thinking about doing a remake.
It has been established that persons who have recently died have been returning to life and committing acts of murder.
You could really see how the original film came out of the 60s and that turbulence, the schism, and this almost like civil war that was going on in society at that point.
There could be 50 million of those things out there.
Who can say why that film took off? I mean, politically there were things going on with, you know, Vietnam and the Cold War, the isolationist thing was going on.
It opened on 14 screens in Pittsburgh, October 2nd, 1968. The world premiere was October 1st, 1968. We figured that we better publicize our own picture, because if it didn't do well in Pittsburgh, it would die right then, and that would be the end of it. First of all, it was called Night of the Flesh Eaters, and George's father, who specialized in advertising motion pictures, made banners and everything else with Night of the Flesh Eaters. And then we got a letter from some lawyer saying that there was a movie called that. So we came up with Night of the Living Dead.
The print arrived in Pittsburgh for our premiere screening in October of 1968. And lo and behold, there was no copyright notice on it. The Reed organization and Continental Pictures failed to put a copyright notice on the picture with that new title.
People would just go out and see no notice on something, and they'd start duplicating it. And we had to chase them down, which we've been doing for 30 years.
It was a wonderful and a terrible standing on our feet education about the movie business. It's great that the first movie you do becomes a classic. It was terrible that none of us saw anywhere near what we knew the kind of business that it was doing. It was just unconscionable.
The only way to stop him, you gotta get him in the head.
Part of the decision to do the remake in 1990 was rooted in that copyright problem. We felt that if we got many of the same group of people back together and remade the picture,
we'd all be a lot better off if all three of us were working together.
That would in some way shore up and help the copyright on the original picture.
It was also an opportunity for the original people involved to finally make some money off the title, Night of the Living Dead.
The unburied dead are coming back to life.
When you start tampering with a classic, there's always the potential of a backlash.
This is bullshit.
Why on earth would you dare to remake a classic?
The man's insane. He's insane.
I had apprehension, of course, in doing the remake.
It's difficult to imagine such a thing actually happening.
This is something that nobody has ever heard about and nobody's ever seen before.
My approach was pretend we didn't see this original film.
First eyewitness accounts of this grisly development came from people who were understandably frightened.
Although I did use your awareness of the original film to manipulate you.
The only reasonable explanation is a germ, a bacteria or a virus that has a mind-altering effect on its victims.
Well, when we first heard about the remake, I mean, we're absolutely elated. I mean, it would be one of our dream projects. I think anybody that does makeup effects would have liked to have done. It just is one of the archetypal movies of all time.
Oh, baby. Oh, my baby.
because of the parodies of zombies, there were beer commercials with zombies, Michael Jackson's Thriller, you know. How can we make these things scary again? And my approach was, we have to really remind people of what death was. I didn't want to ever use the word zombie in the remake. These are dead things. Death is the most important thing to try to make people scared of again. So remakes are a difficult concept. Primarily, I'm known for doing special makeup effects in lots of horror movies. In fact, you could call me, they have called me, the King of Splatter. You know, I was involved in the heyday of the splatter films with Dawn of the Dead, Friday the 13th, I've done two of those, the sequel Day of the Dead. They all started for me when I saw the movie Man of a Thousand Faces. In fact, I wanted to be Lon Chaney. When I saw that movie, I went home and I tried to create on my own face the Phantom, the Hunchback, things that I saw him create. My goal was always to like be an actor in films, and I thought that what would get me in the door would be the special makeup effects. So I try to play a part in the films that I do effects on. I've done stunts, acting, I've directed now, I'm a tournament fencer. If you've seen Dusk Till Dawn, it was my idea to use the bullwhip because I'm pretty good with the bullwhip. So the more I've done, the more I've gotten to do.
Tom Savini is a madman. He's one of these extraordinary people that has this dark side, obviously, but the real Tom Savini, he's a pussycat. He is as sensitive as he is dark. Maybe he's facing his own demons.
Well, I was a combat photographer in Vietnam, and I was seeing horrible stuff through my camera lens, and the camera lens, to me, was a separation between me and this horribly anatomically correct gore that I was seeing, real stuff. I had to click off my emotions in Vietnam as a combat photographer to not go nuts. Well, when I came back, those emotions were still turned off. I was a zombie. Coming back from Vietnam, I was an emotionless person walking around. Seeing that stuff affected how I was to create makeup effects from that point on. To me, if the stuff I created didn't give me the same feeling that I got from seeing the real stuff in Vietnam, it wasn't real enough to me. Something happens to the face in death. Some people die with smiles on their face. An eye was half closed, half open. The jaw always goes slack, which affects how I watch death in movies. Well, we're in Pittsburgh, and if you were born in Pittsburgh, one of the things you want to be when you grow up is a zombie in one of George Romero's dead movies. George is great. He shoots everything in Pittsburgh. He believes, as I believe, you don't have to be in Hollywood to make major movies. When I was in high school, George came to my high school to audition people for a movie called Wine of the Fawn, which never got made. I approached him about doing the makeup for his Night of the Living Dead. He was so busy, I was following him around the studio, flipping pages of my portfolio. He says, yeah, man, we could use you. Unfortunately, they called me to go in the Army right before George shot Night of the Living Dead. So when he did that, I was in Vietnam. I remember him coming to me and saying, we're going to remake Night of the Living Dead. And I'm thinking, oh, great. Finally, I get to do the effects in George's remake of Night of the Living Dead. He says, and I want you to direct it.
George felt, and he had enough confidence in Tom Savini to let that be his feature film directorial debut.
Sometimes when we were on the set of my Night of the Living Dead, I would just think to myself, look where you are. You know, you didn't get to do the original film, and you're here directing the remake, so it made it easier.
Movies are my life. My life is movies.
I wanted the characters in Night of the Living Dead 90 to physically be very similar to the characters in the original.
You know, I won't open this door again.
Until somebody comes who can get us out of here.
His wife and kids downstairs.
My woman's down there too, that's Judy Rose Larson.
There's a radio upstairs and you boarded us in down here?
What do you hope to accomplish?
Shut up, Helen!
There's speculation about why George cast a black actor in the lead of his original film.
You can be the boss down there. I'm boss up here.
All his films seem to be about like the outsider anyway. I feel that he himself kind of considers himself to maybe be outside. I mean, he operates outside of the Hollywood studio system. And so I think he maybe just relates to minorities in that respect. I think it's just another layer of meaning on top of that of how much of an outsider this character is.
What about you, Mr. Ben? You don't exactly look like neighbors yourself.
And of course, I had to cast a black man. Lucky for me, Tony Todd walked in the door.
I'm not deciding for you or anybody else, Cooper. I'm thinking about my own ass.
We handed him the script. And he went out in the hallway for 5 minutes. Came back without the script. Memorized it like that. Tears just came out of him during his audition. I closed the book, said, that's it. We're not looking for Ben anymore. This guy is Ben.
Fight what you're thinking, fight what you're feeling. Fight to keep you strong, keep you thinking straight.
Plus, he was very similar looking to Dwayne Jones.
If you box yourself in the cellar and those things get in the house, you've had it.
Get enough of them together, they may be able to break through the door.
What's your name?
Barbara. In the original Night of the Living Dead, Barbara was a traditional character. She was almost Grecian in her tradition. She's the innocent, vulnerable character that none of us want to be, but we're all afraid we are. She's the scared chick.
And she went catatonic on you and really never left that state.
Oh, only 10 more minutes?
That's all you expected of a woman in that kind of a movie. That's all that was expected of women in general.
Well, we better leave soon.
The 1990 version is more of what was unexpected. I look like this wimpy little school mousy teacher person, not very powerful.
He's going to hear you.
I scream a lot. And then she starts to change. She became a more honest and real and believable woman. She was trying to survive.
You told me to fight. Well, I'm fighting. I'm not panicking.
No one expected that. And that's what makes her work, I think.
I wanted to have a woman hero, too. Sigourney Weaver is a prime example of a woman suddenly kicking ass in Aliens. We wanted that same kind of thing to go on, and it was in the political atmosphere of the time.
We're starting to accept women as being strong, independent, thoughtful people, and not just set decoration.
Scene clear, please. Take two.
What?
When we started shooting, we started with the beginning of the script, which was the graveyard scene. This was springtime in Pittsburgh. We wanted to have the gloomy, rainy kind of thing going on, which I believe is the way it is in the original.
You think I want to blow Sunday on a scene like this?
Instead, we had these glorious, sunshiny, blue days with the birds chirping in the background. It's not scary at all. But in the end, Tom loved it because it was the opposite. It was the opposite of what you expected. And that's what he kept doing in that scene.
Look, there's one of them now.
Look, there comes one of them now.
Oh, no! We're trying to manipulate you in the remake to believe that the first guy you see is a zombie, just like in the first film.
He scares us. We think he's going to be the zombie. Turns out he's just a freaked out old guy.
And that's why I hired my good friend, Pat Reese. He looks like a zombie. He was perfect for me to make you think it's a real zombie. But the real zombie that comes out is Greg Funk, who was also on the effects team.
We needed somebody who was going to be comfortable in the makeup, who could sort of act a little bit, be a good zombie, and do stunts.
And I wanted him to look like an old picture I saw from Famous Monsters. He initially started out to be this picture of Dorian Gray character. Johnny is killed. And I wanted his death to be more graphic than the original film. In fact, we even built this lovely dummy of Bill Moseley, and I had the zombie crush his head into the tombstone. Again, it's more emotional for people when they see it happen. They can feel and go, oh, God, that must have hurt. When the film came out and I watched that, everybody did go, oh!
I remember one of the more controversial moments is what we call the autopsy zombie.
This is a fresh guy, right from the funeral home. So when Barbara runs back to the car after being attacked and sees this kind of a good-looking guy walking toward the car, she seeks his help. And then when you go to the back of this good-looking guy, the clothing has been slit up the back, which is what undertakers do to dress a dead body. Barbara only is aware of that when the guy starts walking toward the camera. In the storyboards, I clearly wanted his feet to start dragging his clothes down, and you see that he's been autopsied. That, to me, was a hideous moment that is not in the script, something we added. I think of special makeup effects as magic tricks. Anybody in the business as a special makeup effects artist thinks the same thing. These are magic tricks. We are fooling you into believing what you're seeing. In fact, my books are called Grand Illusions because I think of them as magic tricks.
We built a dummy that we actually propped up with all these little wires and strings that the car actually rammed into. It was an articulated dummy where the joints were actually accurate, so it moved right. And then once he fell on the ground, we actually buried Dirk halfway in a hole, and we had fake legs sticking impossibly out of one section of his body. That's the archetypal Tom Savini effect. This is what Tom Savini, in my mind, is known for, and it's what I learned from him. Tom actually, designed that effect, and we just executed it. And I remember working with him on Day of the Dead. I remember countless times he would come up with some effect that I just thought was like the most harebrained idea that I was convinced was never going to work, and it would work, and it'd be brilliant. He was really, really well-versed in stage magic.
The magician makes you look here while he's pulling flowers out of his butt back here. You know, I've misdirected you. We do the same thing in films. You know, make something happen on the right side of the screen so when the monster pops out, it scares you. That's a misdirection. A magician also uses mechanical devices that you're not aware of, and that's what we do. You're not aware of the mechanical devices in a fake head that might appear for 3 seconds before it gets blown apart. That's our mechanical device. We are makeup effects magicians.
In the original film, we had to create makeups for our zombie beings that were within budgetary bounds. We had to keep it simple, basic, and primitive. In the 1990 remake, John Vulich and Everett Burrell did a fantastic job. The technology of special effects makeup was definitely on their side.
I had heard from John as a fan, as a young kid, writing letters to me and showing me his masks.
It's wonderful.
We started working with Tom early on, actually both Everett and I, on Day of the Dead. One of the things that I've learned is that we don't necessarily just do makeup, we create characters. And we create characters that help to tell a story.
They actually used a computer to take a picture of somebody and design zombies on the computer way back then. The key zombies all wore these special lenses, so the eyes were gone. So if you looked in the eyes, nobody there. Erase the eyes, you erase the person. So that's what we tried to do with the zombies in my version, is try to get rid of their eyes and make them soulless.
Some of our early brainstorming sessions really centered around trying to be very clinically real about it. A lot of times the work that we do necessitates that you look at forensic photos, and this just happened to be the right kind of look for what we were looking for. At one point, I didn't go, but all the other guys in the shop went to an autopsy firsthand to see it.
The zombies were hired mostly locally. They had zombie auditions.
You put an ad in the paper. We need 3,000 zombies.
Extras driving from Kentucky to be in the remake, they had to expand their extras casting because the turnout to be zombies was so great.
If you were in the neighborhood, you were a zombie. I thought that the zombies in the original film were very believable in how they moved. They were very slow. They looked mindless. My idea was, if you're a dead thing, if you're a human being who has suddenly come back to life, or life has been given to this hunk of dead flesh, it would have to learn how to move again. We had a zombie school. The idea was to get a movement instructor in to teach these people who were going to be zombies what looked the best as a zombie. The zombie who plays the autopsy zombie, that's Tim Carrier. He is a movement instructor. And so Tim Carrier headed up a school for teaching zombies. But it backfired on us because it looked funny. People were, you know, just doing incredibly wild things. And it wound up, just move slow. And it was the same thing, I think, that George said to zombies in the original film.
To have a cast of hundreds of zombies around gets a little disgusting after a while. Their ears were falling off, and flesh-peeling eyeballs were hanging down, and just, oof.
The zombie that stands out the most to me in the remake is the Uncle Reed zombie.
The Uncle Reed zombie is a friend of mine who I've known for 35 years, Pat Logan.
Pat Logan is a real interesting character. He was a cop in Pittsburgh. This big guy.
He had a motorcycle accident 6 weeks before we shot that scene. They took his collarbone, he took out his spleen, he was in, ribs were broken. 6 weeks later, he did the stunt. Now, Barbara has to fight Uncle Reed with this fireplace poker. We had a rubber one and a real one for the impact to see the actual hits. When it was really Pat, it was the rubber one. When it was Pat's dummy, it was the real one, smacking this fake dummy. And I hope you can't tell the difference.
The other zombie that really flipped me out was the bald, real skinny one that came in through the window.
He was just a cab driver that Savini had taken a cab ride with and said, "You gotta be in my movie."
He followed me around that night going, "I'm gonna get you. I'm gonna get you, Barbara."
One of the things we wanted to do is, traditionally, anytime you do bullet hits in a movie, Somebody's almost always wearing a shirt. They're always wearing a shirt. I wanted to do something where we just broke that cliche, where we just hit them against flesh. So we actually built the guy's chest up fairly thick. I mean, thicker than it probably looks in the film.
And then we blew squibs right through the foam latex appliance.
No! Is he dead? You're all seeing this. Is he dead?
Stop it!
And it was a great effect, because we were able to show something you don't normally see in a film when somebody is hit by bullets, seeing flesh get explode with squibs.
How many bullets does this thing hold?
The other scene that's a standout scene, only because I didn't realize it at the time, but I get a lot of comments on, is when Barbara leaves the house and there's the girl zombie with her doll.
And it turned out to be a great moment of pathos for Barbara to be confronted by this zombie who is carrying a baby doll as if she's carrying her own baby. And she's the one that Barbara, when she sees her, pushes her away from her and is really hesitant about shooting.
Oh, God!
I guess that's one of those isolated things that I'm proud of having achieved. Wow, I brought honesty to that moment and that people remember it.
Tom and the MPAA did not quite see eye to eye.
Because with my name on the film and George Romero's on the film, you expect a blood fest.
The MPAA said this is an X and there's no way you'll ever get an R.
You know, when they said cut something, they just cut it. You know, I would have been fighting for it.
That graphic, very, very graphic depiction of the headshot was something that they were not fond of.
Right now, it turns out it's kind of a sterile film, but in a way, that's okay. Because it may sound strange coming from me, but the less you show, the better it is. When the audience completes it in their head, it's more visceral. They create it more bloody than you can possibly show it as an effect. Like Mr. Magruder's head.
It's not Mr. Magruder!
When you have to fill in the blanks of his head exploding.
It's not Mr. Magruder!
It's a lot more gross than what we would have created.
In the original film, I played the character of Johnny.
I don't even remember what the man looks like.
I play a character in the remake. There is a dolly shot coming off of Pat Tallman as she's waking up the morning after. And as the camera dollies past us, I am in the process of saying, yeah, they're dead, they're all messed up.
Yeah, they're dead, they're all messed up.
George wrote a line towards the end of the movie where Barbara does find people who are alive, and she sees a sport being made of the zombies by all the rednecks.
They're us. We're them, they're us.
These hideous things are no different than the hideous things now playing with them.
They were human once too, and they're just victims of whatever this is that's happening.
A lot of films you see that take place in our time reflect what's going on in our time.
Doesn't take long for the world to fall apart, does it?
Are you sure we're going to be all right?
It's being called Judgment Day.
For a film to be lasting, I think it has to have meaning for one generation or another. And now the meaning might be something like AIDS.
Doctors at the Center for Disease Control in Atlanta reject that theory.
AIDS was falling on us. This new thing, this new disease was falling on us.
One of those people bitter on the arm.
The only reasonable explanation is a germ, a bacteria or a virus.
50 years from now might have a totally different meaning.
This is pure hell on earth.
Either it's some archetypal timeless fear, or it's something that you can relate to, or it's just something you'll always be able to relate to.
God damn you! God damn all of you!